Welcome back to this interaction session. Now we will start the second interaction session. So a quick note to all the remote centers, all the participants. So the course instructors, as part of the and both the FDP, we are taking an effort to reach out to each different RCs, both during the interaction session and also when the FDP online component is going on. And all these visits and interactions from the different remote centers is done as part of that. So we really understand the effort put in by each and every faculty, taking their time to do all the activities within the within this both the courses. And to show you our support, we are actually going to most of the RCs as far as possible. So even after the end of the FDP also, these RC visits will be made, where we will be interacting with the FDP participants to get their feedback, to motivate them and to clarify their queries. So I'll just hand it over to Dr. Samir to give a few notes. So he had some few recollections within his 2 days interaction. Dr. Samir.
Yes, this is Samir reporting from Rajalakshmi Engineering College in Chennai. And I have been in Chennai from yesterday morning, where I first visited Anna University Remote Center, then Loyola ICAM in the afternoon. And today morning I went to Savita Engineering, and then now I am at Rajalakshmi. By far, the enthusiasm can be felt in the work that has been put up by faculty members. There were a couple of good practices which I could see. What I realized, Jay Krishnan, that there are a lot of interesting things happening at individual faculty levels as well as at the RC level also. However, one observation is that what Professor Phatak's ideology was about the interaction day has to be implemented much more effectively. For example, he means that this possibility of getting 50, 30, 20, 100 faculty at one time at a place is a very big asset, and that should be exploited appropriately. However, that is not happening, is what my observation was. So 100 people come together, but most of them will stick around with their friends all the time and not interact with other 98 people who are present in the room, thereby losing this opportunity of sharing what they have done. So when I tried to do this experiment in a college of asking the best practices, what they have found out while talking to mentor in the mentor-mentee interaction, one gentleman told me that a screencast was done by the mentor of this entire mentor-mentee interaction. And that mentor made it available as a downloadable video so that he could recollect that. Now, this is a very good practice. If that is shared, then other mentees can start requesting mentors to do the same, or they can do it themselves and make it useful for people. There was also an option of sharing the screen with all the mentees. So this kind of things were done. However, they were not saved or maybe documented by people. So that was one thing which can be actually publicized, and a lot of people can do that. So one suggestion is that we should have a time slot in this interaction session where best practices observed during mentor-mentee interaction should be shared by the remote center attendees to all the other remote centers. Other thing was that some faculty members have created their own videos, and they have used it in their classrooms along with the existing course at IIT Bombay X or some part of that, and they have tried something. Now, this kind of experiments are done. However, the documentation is not available to others, so they may not learn from it. So that also, maybe we can do that. The third is, which is interesting to me, I found that every remote center has perfected their own process of maintaining the AView setup. I wanted to request Sajjan that if he can put up a process by which we can generate tutorials of maintaining the AView setup in multiple languages using the remote center coordinators at various states. We can have a repository of this in multiple languages right then and there. And maybe we can use this as AV creation activity also as part of our FDP and get this thing done. Maybe because I realized the event, and Professor Nagappan told me at Savita that whenever there is a problem in any RC in Tamil Nadu especially, they will call him and ask him what is the solution. So then require sometimes, especially the operator level people at RC require a local language support, which is not available and which I cannot imagine Sajjan Dixit talking all 29 Indian languages or even Sushant doing that. So it's better that we decentralize this activity and create a repository of such tutorials in local languages as a part of this AV creation. So we have maybe two birds in one. So what we can achieve probably here. I have a couple of problems also mentioned here during the mentor-mentee interaction. One of them was the time clashes, like whenever the mentees are available and mentor is absconding and vice versa, which was slightly a ticklish issue. There were issues regarding AView installation and other things which have been sorted. Again, I repeat the same point. If we can figure out people making tutorials about this thing in local language, that can be sorted at a much larger level. There were also things like, because of, I don't know, bandwidth or any other reason, mentors sometimes stopped the video chat and went ahead with textual chat, which was not probably appreciated by some mentee. And they said that we wanted to actually see people, and this actually matters. I wanted to bring back what Professor Phatak has been saying. Utilize this interaction time to the fullest by meeting people, discussing, talking to them about what they are doing, sharing what you are doing with them, and make the most out of it, because the costliest item on the entire list is getting a bunch of people at the same time in the same room. So with this, back to Mumbai.
Thank you, Dr. Samir. The idea of, there are two, three points. One is we need a better documentation of all the processes. And second is the AView setup process in multiple languages. So this could very well be taken as part of the open education resource creation. So we will definitely circulate this idea also as part of our open education resource. Regarding time slot for sharing best practices, so something that we did yesterday in the final session is somewhere going towards this. We did a team pair solo where people had to interact, and rather than doing it at the center, what the participants did was they visited WordPress pages created by other RCs and provided clarifications to the queries raised by them. So again, we were trying to build up online collaboration and also creation of a pool of questions and most frequently asked questions or challenging questions related to the technology and solutions to it. But we will definitely consider the in the second set of interactions on October 6th and 7th. We will be having dedicated time slot for sharing of best practices. We will definitely consider this. Regarding the time slots clash, mentor-mentee interaction, I'm not sure what could be done, but yes, some measures could be. So we'll think of some logistics arrangement from our side. The first set of mentor-mentee interaction will start from this Thursday, that is week 2. So we will think of maybe adjusting the slots such that there is much more flexibility. But yeah, this has to be, we will look at this particular process for sure. So let me just start with my session till and once Professor Phatak arrives at Mewar University, we'll go back to interaction with them. The second session is about using Moodle for higher order learning outcomes from students. So in the previous session, there were few queries to Professor Sridhar where participants asked about how to align activities so that the learning outcomes are attained from the students and how to ensure that syllabus completion happens. So there were multiple queries. So this is an attempt just to see, so we will not be addressing specifically the issue related to syllabus, but rather we will be giving a more generic view about what this entire process is about and why should you leave out the concern about syllabus, particularly when it comes to outcome based education. So this is a triangle of effective teaching learning. So on top of this triangle, so every teaching learning process will have these three core aspects that every faculty has to consider. And the first is the learning objectives, second is the instructional activities, and third is the assessment. Now when you do it, so for making this teaching learning process effective, it is important that when you set up your learning objectives first, you should think of this particular question. What do I want students to know they learn a given module? So what do I want the students to know from a module? What do I want them to learn or exhibit? That should be the first consideration while setting up the objective. Then you should set up instructional activities such that what kind of activities inside and outside of classroom will reinforce the teaching learning process and prepare students for exhibiting the objectives that were set up for them. And the third and most crucial aspect is the assessment, where the faculty now have to think of what kinds of tasks will reveal whether students have achieved what they were expected to know or what they were expected to perform. So this triangle of effective teaching learning, regardless of whether it is with technology or without technology, is going to be the same, because all of you are now focusing on the learner and what the learner should achieve, and the outcomes are set up at the learning objectives, instructional activities you perform in the classroom, but by making it more active you could ensure that the effectiveness increases, and the assessment should be tied to the objectives. And when technology comes in, what technology actually helps is to increase the efficiency of the process. So you could do a lot of things with technology, provided you plan ahead and you plan in this systematic manner. First, the learning objectives, then the instructional activities, and finally the assessment. So when you use any technology, think of this teaching learning triangle, and then think of integrating the technology into the classroom. So I believe Professor Phatak has arrived at Mewar University, and I'll just do a floor transfer to him, and he'll be speaking more about how this FDP is going to guide you towards creating better teaching learning triangles. So it's over to Mewar University.
Good morning, and thank you for letting me share my thoughts. You've given me an additional task of convincing people on how to implement that triangle. I'm not so sure whether I'll be able to do that or not, but I thought I will first begin by addressing some concern that many participants have. And many of them have mentioned through emails and other mechanisms that sometimes they find it very hard to cope up with the workload, especially when they are already engaged in their regular teaching assignments. Of course, I understand that, and this activity definitely puts a stress about 6 to 8 hours a week extra will have to be spent by every participant. My only answer is, life is hard. There is no shortcut to hard work. There will be occasions when you would be relatively free, even in your academic load. You can utilize that time maximally, but some extra work will have to be done. Please appreciate that the country has no choice but to conduct such FDPs across the entire year, throughout the year, because the ambition is to reach out first to 3.5 lakh teachers in professional institutions and subsequently 1 million more in general higher education. I am not even talking about school teachers, which are much larger in number. You will all agree that the use of technology in education and the pedagogy that we are studying here is going to be very useful. And therefore, we don't have the luxury of choosing either the weekend, either the vacation period and such thing for doing this. We'll have to do it along with our regular tasks only. Having said that, let me come back to my favorite point. One of the objectives in this entire exercise is to convince ourselves of encouraging collaboration. This collaboration is for what purpose? Ordinarily, you already seen think, pair, share and group kind of activities, how they significantly enhance active learning. But I am speaking of something much more than that. Larger problem solving, particularly professional problem solving, when our students pass out their engineering degrees or architecture degrees or whatever, when they go out, much of the real world hard problems are required to be solved by teams of people. And unless we are well versed with the methodology of properly collaborating, efficiently collaborating, and effectively collaborating, we will not be able to solve those problems. It is for this reason that we would like to encourage collaboration. Surprisingly, when people collaborate, even the learning happens far more effectively. How do you make students collaborate? One way is to make them think in our classroom exercises like think, pair, share. But there are other mechanisms. You can form teams of students. For example, there are many courses which are taught in IIT, which invariably have a component called a group project, where 3 or 4 students together will have to solve a problem. This kind of activity can be encouraged. Collaboration between the teacher and students is also important. I will take a slightly different path to suggest that whenever our MTech students and research scholars are engaged in research activities, well, I don't really separate out research from education. I genuinely believe that these two are two sides of the same coin called knowledge, and therefore education and research has to go simultaneously. Many of the colleges in the country are still essentially undergraduate institutions and are building the research culture. It will be very important for them to understand the importance of the significance of collaborative work, because research invariably is a collaborative activity where a lot of people will work together. You will find that even education is a very collaborative activity. If we believe that collaboration is limited only among students, that is not correct. Many teachers who teach same or similar subjects in IIT Bombay routinely collaborate, routinely talk to each other, routinely share slides, routinely share significant points to be made, routinely share the standard difficult parts that the students face. And by this, each one of us is enriched. I would strongly suggest that faculty groups within the institutions should start collaborating in this fashion amongst themselves. As far as this FDP is concerned, let me remind all participants that you are actually students in a class, and therefore you will have to collaborate. Now, in this pedagogy portion, there is an important exercise which is essentially a team exercise where you have to build an open educational resource. I speak about open educational resource in a short while. But what is most important is that the teams which form to undertake such an OER creation activity need to collaborate meaningfully and effectively. It should not happen that a team has 4 or 5 people and there is only one person who is doing everything and others are what I call sleeping partner. That's not a very healthy practice. Every partner in the team must contribute. What will happen, unfortunately, is that the teams which are formed are not necessarily at the same physical place. I hope that the teams are formed such that four or five people who constitute the team are generally in the same town so that they can meet together. We are trying to say that they should form teams such that they have the same mentor so that they can interact appropriately. Collaboration does not mean sitting once in a month for half an hour and discussing things. Collaboration means continuous understanding of what other people are thinking and doing. And the only way you can keep track of this is ensuring that you set up an equivalent of your own discussion forum, you set up an equivalent of your own group email IDs, and regularly write emails. In fact, I would make it obligatory that every member of a team where all members are supposed to be collaborating must write one email every day to all the members. If you have nothing specific to say, you say, how are you today? The point is, you have to relate. And to relate to people, I tell you, it's an extremely satisfying experience in itself. But when you relate to people and form a group, believe me, these collaborations could become lifelong lasting collaborations. So collaboration has an extremely important part, not only in education, but in general life. And I would like all participants to actually practice it and imbibe it in their own hearts. Let me take a few minutes to tell you about the open educational resource. All of you are familiar with OER in general. But I find that there is a tremendous ignorance about the concept of intellectual property rights. I have seen that in the first submissions where people were to prepare WordPress site and they were to set up some material on the website. There are many who have chosen images from Google search. And they say, oh, this is from Google. So they genuinely believe that anything that Google shows off is actually free to use. Far from the truth, it is not so at all. Google is a search engine. And it will search everything in the world, on the entire web. You have to be very careful whenever you use a resource. Wikipedia resource is perhaps a better resource. But you also have to take care when you use a resource which is in open source, but you need to cite the right citation for the use of that resource. I would very strongly suggest that you should access Wikipedia. Collect three or four articles. There is a mechanism by which these articles can be collected and a single collection can be given to you as a booklet. If you create such a booklet, you will find, let's say you have four articles collected, you'll actually find five chapters in that collection. The first four are referring to the four articles. The fifth chapter is merely a detailed list of acknowledgement of what source has been taken from what place, who is the owner of the IPR and so on so forth. So even in the open source, people have to be extremely careful about acknowledging as to where you have got. Openness is typically defined in two different ways. Typically for the open software, they use the GNU public license or the variants. And for other creative resources, we use Creative Commons license. As you are aware, we have decided that all material that is created through such programs, including our previous workshops, will be released under Creative Commons CC BY SA license. We are building a repository in IIT where all such material will be kept. But it is very important to understand why we are emphasizing open educational resources in particular and open resources, knowledge resources in general. The point is, if I want someone to use a resource, that someone should not be bogged down by legal problems. For example, a chart is prepared by somebody which, let's say, gives some physical properties or chemical properties of a compound. If that chart is part of a book which is published by a publisher, the chart unfortunately belongs to that publisher as the intellectual property. I can do a fair use of such a chart when I use that chart to explain something to my 50 students. But I can't modify that chart. I can't distribute that chart. Whereas if the same chart was released in open source, then not only anybody can use it, but anybody can modify, anybody can act. We would like all our video recorded clips, the interactions, the question answers, and the OERs that are created to be available as a general resource to all the teachers in the, not only in this country, but in the entire world. And available not in a hypothetical sense. Available means not only I can download, I can edit, I can modify, and I can release, and I can distribute it to thousands of my people. Provided, of course, I acknowledge what it is. I should not palm off some open educational resource, add two lines to it, and say, D.B. Phatak wrote this. That will be a criminal activity. We should not indulge in. Now, while open educational resources can be created by individuals, and there are several instances of brilliant and beautiful and useful OERs being created by individuals. But I submit that if we work collectively, the quality of such an OER can be much better. After all, if I write even two paragraphs, many times I am unable to find errors in those two paragraphs. But if some friend of mine reads that those two paragraphs, within 5 minutes the friend is able to find four errors. Beautiful use of collaboration is to find each other's mistake and to complement each other's strength so that the total effort that goes in produces something which is long-lasting and which is extremely useful. In the first instance, when you create an OER collaboratively, please worry about these points as much. What will be the use of that OER that you are creating? And use not only as is. Is it modifiable? Is it editable? Have you acknowledged everything that you have used from other sources, including open source? And is the quality good? You must strive to get the best quality OER, because please note that once you submit that OER, that will bear your names. Four people have created that OER, those four names are permanently attached to that OER. Subsequently, when we put it on the OER repository of IIT Bombay and thousands of people download it, each one can say, oh, this OER has this mistake, this OER has this problem. And therefore, you must strive to make the best quality OER that is possible. In conclusion, I will say that the concept of collaboration is far more important than just in teaching learning processes. But in the teaching learning processes, we must encourage significant collaboration among students. It is not easy, by the way, because we have spent our lifetime in asking each student to work independently. In fact, if a student as much as looks at other students' work, we say he's copying. Whereas we are saying, essentially, please encourage people to copy. Please encourage people to talk to each other. Please encourage people to understand from each other. So let us not confuse between the assessment, which is an individual assessment, and during that assessment, the student must not collaborate. But other than the assessment, everywhere else, the students must collaborate. And they will collaborate only when they see us, teachers, also collaborate. This collaboration is actually an infectious disease. If others find that people are collaborating and they are collaborating to their advantage, they will also start doing it. In the context of this FDP, the maximum collaboration is required, of course, as I said, to create a beautiful, wonderful, and useful open educational resource of which not only you, but all users will also be proud of. That's all I wanted to share for the day. Thank you very much. Over to you, Jackie. Yeah.
Thank you, Professor Phatak, for once again your inspiring words. The idea of collaboration, let me just tell you that over the last lab session, the participants in the remote centers were actively collaborating in a exercise called Team Pair Solo, where as a team, they created a WordPress web page for their own RC, and in that, all the participants from that RC contributed questions that they had about all the four technologies that we exposed them in FDP 101. There were questions about Moodle, CamStudio or Screencast-O-Matic. There was questions about AView. There were questions even about WordPress. And what the other RC participants, participants from other remote centers were doing is, they were looking at these questions and were trying to answer some of those questions which they know answer to. So let's say there are somebody had an issue with Moodle file upload and he posted it in the question repository, then the other participant from other RC will look at this question and comment back to the question saying that to do this, you can do so and so, you can easily upload, you can use a drive. Those kind of solutions will be provided by other RCs. So we have a list of these remote center web pages, and what we are going to do at the end of this entire FDP is, we will put these, all these remote center web page links in the main FDP WordPress website. So we have created a WordPress web page for the FDP itself. So we'll be adding a new page where all the links to the remote center web pages will be provided. So let's continue with this session, where we are looking specifically at the technology of Moodle to ensure that the effective teaching learning triangle is attained. So the recall that in FDP 101X, as part of RCA 02, you had done the following three activities. First one, a file upload of, you created a course in Moodle and then did the file uploads. You did a video share, that is video upload or this of the screencast that you created, and a quiz which was connected to the video. Now, at each remote center, all participants have to think, how easy was this? How easy was the process of file upload? Was it easy or was it complex? Just two choices. Think about it for 30 seconds. So to the coordinator, the workshop coordinator or remote center coordinator who is handling the AVU, please ask the participants to do a hand raise and let us know in your RC, how many felt that file upload is easy? So instead of AVU poll, you can just post your answer in the chat. Okay, I see a lot of answers coming in, 100%, 90%, 100%, greater than 90, 100%, 100% easy. So I see figures close to above 90 or somewhere above 90. Yes, the answers are coming in. So somebody is saying that more than 5%. So we will just have a look. There are some RCs where people found it difficult. So for participants who found this activity as difficult, the steps that you had to do was, first click on the add an activity or resource that you will get after turning editing on. After that, click on the file and then you could actually set up. So whatever file is, you could just upload it over there. So this is actually an easy to construct process of uploading a file. But now think, which of the following four are happening when you do this file upload process? So these are the learning purposes for which you do that particular, use that particular technology. So first, information transfer. Second, to assess learning. Third, communication and interaction. Fourth, co-create content. Look at the questions that are associated with each of these options. To see whether it is an information transfer process, all you have to think about is the use of the feature for disseminating information from you as a teacher to your students. If it is for assessing learning, you have to think of whether this feature will allow you to assess your students' learning. For the third, you should think of whether it could be used for communication and interaction among participants. And fourth, for co-creation, can you, the teacher, and your students collaborate and create content together. So this is towards the thought what Professor Fatak said earlier. It's the collaboration between, not just between students, it's between both the teacher and the students. So what will happen when you do this upload file? Which of the learning purpose is actually happening? So you can post your answers through AVU chat. So 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1 and 3, 1. So a lot of you are saying that 1 will happen, and there are other options that are actually coming in. So the answer to this is that just by file upload, only information transfer is happening. There is no communication and interaction that is happening either synchronously or asynchronously. There is no assessment that is happening, and there is no co-creation. So as a teacher, you just create the file and upload it. When it is communication, then there will be some discussion on what file has been uploaded, and just by the using of this feature of file upload, there is no explicit communication that is happening. It is only facilitating information transfer. Let's repeat the same exercise for the second item. In the Moodle, you had done a quiz. How easily did you set up a quiz? Was it an easy process or was it complex? Think about it, this question, for 30 seconds, and then within your RC, just raise your hand to the next question. So first think about it now. How easy was it to set up a quiz with all the questions, the feedback, and all those process when you did RCA 02 in FDP 101X? So now for the remote center coordinator, now look at this question. In your RC, how many felt that setting up quiz was difficult? So take a count and let us know how many felt this activity was difficult. Yeah, chat. You can post your answers using chat. So there are some centers where people are saying that more than 50% or more than 90% found it difficult, whereas in some other centers, people are saying more than 5% only found it difficult. So by putting the options in decreasing order, what it means is that more than 5%, so it actually lies in between 5 and 50%. Just to clarify. So yes, so some people found that setting up a quiz was a difficult process. 100% of the participants found it difficult. So what do you do in setting up a quiz? Again, you first click on add an activity or resource, you select the quiz button, but you see there are lot of options that you have to set up. The timing, the grades associated with it, how the layout is, how will the question behave, will it be immediate feedback or feedback at a later point of time, when will the questions be available for review, I mean answers be available of review. How should it be displayed? Any extra restrictions on attempts? Is there an overall feedback that has to be given based on the grades that are coming in, and the common module settings? So for constructing effective quizzes, it actually takes time and it is a slightly longer process. Now, think out of the four processes, which one is happening when you do a quiz in Moodle. So you are using the feature of quiz. Which of the below is actually happening when you set up a quiz and students take that quiz? So again, the four options: information transfer, assess learning, communication and interaction, and co-creation of content. You can post the answers through AVU chat. So by using quiz, let me again clarify that the quiz is set up by the instructor. There is no, Professor Fatak said, there is no copying or no collaboration at that process. So I see that many of the participants are providing almost the correct answer. The answer to this question is we'll be doing assessment of learning while setting up a quiz. So we will, this feature is actually will be able will be helping you in assessing how much your students have learnt. So it's more or less as a summative assessment that we are using quizzes typically in Moodle. So there is a third feature in Moodle which we have not explored too much. This is the discussion forum. Again, like file upload, this is easy to construct. You click add activity or resource and select the discussion forum button from there. Over here, it is more or less straightforward now. So which of the below is happening? Within discussion forums, we are doing lot of communication and interaction, where it's not just communication and interaction between the students, but both by the teacher and the students as well. So communication between teacher and students as well. So recollect what we do in learning experience interaction. So all of there is a guided and focused question on which we ask all the participants to start a discussion. So to effectively use discussion forums, what is important is that there should be a guided or focused question on which this interaction can happen, and it should not be left open-ended. Let's see one last feature, which is called Wiki. Many would not have used this in Moodle, but Wikis is something like, so Wikipedia is a wiki. So it's a feature that allows participants to create their own content and also allow collaboration between participants. So the same a wiki page can be created by a student, and he can allow other students also to come and edit that content. So based on the settings of the wiki, you could edit the content, which makes this particular feature, the focus will be on more on co-creation of content. So both you and your students collaborate and create content together. So there will be some sort of communication and interaction happening, but the larger purpose of a wiki is to co-create content. So key takeaway from this session is that, so somebody asked today morning how to select appropriate strategy. So again, our message is the same. If you are using whatever be the technology that you are using, be it Moodle, be it Screencast or the others, you should make students grapple with content within that technology. So in this case, it is Moodle. And to achieve the higher order objectives, do not just only clarify doubts. Use features of Moodle where learners work with the content or co-create content. And also use features to ensure avenues for discussion among learners. So peer discussion should be promoted within Moodle. And for this, you could now look at these four features: discussion forum, wiki, lessons, glossary, and database. So all of you are aware of the demo Moodle site. So one activity that each of you should go, it's a home assignment, go to the demo Moodle site and explore these five features: discussion forums, wikis, lessons, glossary, and database, to understand how they have used these features. And essentially, to achieve the higher order objectives, what you have to do is, be it any technology, look at what is happening, what is the learning purpose for which you are using the technology, and ensure that activities are provided in the third and fourth learning purposes to ensure that there is a lot of interaction, engagement, and then put at higher order levels. This will ensure that higher order learning happens within both interaction and co-creation. So once again, the takeaways: make students grapple with content within Moodle, do not only clarify doubts, you can do active learning within Moodle itself. But you will have to use features that promote this active learning where students are continuously engaged and they think beyond whatever is given. They are given questions, they are given activities that will allow them to move beyond just information transmission to do more application of whatever content is provided. And also, you should promote features of discussion and co-creation through peer discussions. So, this is all about use of Moodle for higher order learning among your students. So, what I'll do now is, I'll do interaction with remote centers for the remaining half an hour, and you can ask me your queries regarding either use of Moodle or use of any technology for higher order learning. So, what I'm doing is, I've just refreshed my hand raise. People can start doing hand raise and also post questions in the question tab. So, it's 12:30 right now. For the first 15 minutes, I'll do interaction with centers, and for the remaining 15 minutes, I'll answer questions directly from the question tab. RC1138, Rajalakshmi College.
Sir, I have a doubt regarding how to make all the students present in a class to be attentive, because I find it difficult to make all the students be interactive.
So, again, I think this is a question that most of you would be having, but if you there is no direct answer to the question about how to make all the students interactive, how to student make them attend the class. Active learning strategies are one way of doing it, and as Professor Sridhar said in the earlier session, if 80% of your students are interacting and they get 80% of the content, or they achieve 80% of the objectives that you have set up, I think that is a good valid benchmark that you can rely on to understand how effective was your teaching learning process.
Okay, I am asking on her behalf. What she asked me couple of minutes back was that she found out that there is a constant number of these 20% across all the subjects who are non-interested in education, engineering education at a broader level. Now, these 20% are present everywhere in every class, and they have the same non-reactive mode. So, what is a measure to get those in action is the slightly very large question she had. So, I wrote to Phatak sir that please answer this question before he left.
Okay. The question is, I think it is a general question that many of you will have. So, there are no, easy or direct answers, but see, one or few things that we have experienced when we do these blended MOOCs or the other kind of face-to-face workshops. When we do lot of these active learning strategies, after let's say 4 to 5, all the students within the classroom will slowly start participating. So, in the first few active learning, let's say when we are doing think, pair, share, and you see a group of students not participating, you will have to cajole them, you will have to motivate them and involve them in the groups where, and let's say give them some incentive for participating in such sessions, because you are actually catering to the affective domain where they understand that by participation I will be benefited and my voice is also heard by the teacher as well as the other students, which could act as a motivator for them to participate in the other activities. So, this is a very slow and time taking process, but once you start doing most of the activities, active learning activities, you will slowly start seeing students participating in it. So, I hope I have answered your query at least partially. Let's move on to the next institute, RC1111, RVS College of Engineering.
Our video is, there is some issue in the video.
No problem.
So, is it audible, sir?
Yes, you are audible, ma'am.
Okay, so we have lab sessions, no sir, only after your presentations only we are doing the lab sessions.
Okay.
And this time you have extended the lab assignment duration also.
Okay.
We can, you are given 1 week duration.
Yes.
So in between the process, if we get any queries or to clarification, how can we contact you or through mail or some means to communicate with you?
So,
because for any clarifications regarding the lab assessment.
Okay. So clarification.
We need it.
Yeah, so clarification regarding lab assessment. So one thing for sure is whenever you are sending out an email to eOutreach, it will be forwarded to me and the clarification will be obtained. Another thing is that, so what I'll personally do is every day between 4 to 5 or I'll put up a scheduled slot where I will be available in the Padlet. So I'll be monitoring the Padlet continuously. And if there are queries, you can just post a comment. So I'll put up a new post in the Padlet where I'll be asking you to post your queries. So I'll log in using my personal ID in Padlet and I'll put up a post.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so you can ask your queries over there and I'll try to clarify this queries. And I am also, for all the other RCs and participants who are looking into the Padlet, they can also chip in and answer these queries if they think that they know the solutions to the queries that are being raised by every RC.
Okay, it will be commonly visible to all the thing, all
yes.
the RCs, so that they can also help us. Also, by meantime, you also will help us.
So it's like every day I'll be putting up a slot. So based on my schedule over here. Every day I'll be intimating you the time that I'll be looking at Padlet, specifically Padlet. So you know that at that time I'll be available. So you can post your questions before that and then afterwards you can look into Padlet to see what the answers are coming at. Okay?
Okay, sir. We have to log in with our Gmail or with the RC Gmail, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Anything would do. So even if you post as anonymous, that is fine. You can just put a, when you type in, you can say that this is a query from so-and-so RC. Even that is fine. So you need not even log in. But I will log in using my personal ID so that people know that I am answering those questions.
Okay, sir. That's fine, sir. And also regarding Moodle, is there any possibility to check the video was seen by the students after login?
Video was seen by the student. Okay, so this query I think everyone will be having. How to ensure that students actually viewed the video? Now there is a small button called completion button that you can enable, but it only will say that so the students can mark the button after watching the video. But again, exact analytics, if you want to look at it, so if the video is in YouTube, you can just go to the YouTube analytics and see whether between that time period, somebody has actually viewed the video or watched the video. But I think the focus should not, this is a general message to all participants. The focus should not be on whether participants watched the video or the students watched the video. The focus should be on looking at whether the students are gaining the necessary outcome. So that is why we say that every video should be a learning dialogue immediately followed by a learning by doing activity. So by setting up this quiz immediately after the video, you can actually check whether they have actually watched the video, because you are worried about whether they are learning the content.
Okay. And one more question, sir. Do we generate a report from the Moodle, sir, after for quiz or any assignments we have posted there? Is there any report generation possibility
sir? Reports, you can do report generation. If you have a teacher access, basically the administrator sets it up. The activity log is available for you to download. And you can also do the grade report also, you can download.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Let me now go to 1311. 63 RVR and JC College, Guntur.
Hello.
Hello.
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, one query is that can we get a feedback from the students after they take the quiz in Moodle?
Yes, it is possible.
No, because we have options.
So the question is, can feedbacks be obtained from students at the end of quiz? So there is a feature called survey, which you can you give immediately after the quiz activity, where you say that after end of quiz, you do this survey. So this survey will be visible, where you can actually set up, how easy was this quiz? Were you able to answer questions, etc.?
So one more question. We were asked to give a 250 word response in the box, and we were asked to cover 3 points in that summary.
Okay.
And is it necessary that we need to provide an evidence of what we have done in the classroom? If so, if we give the URL, would it be sufficient?
Okay. So this question is regarding RCS 01. Is it necessary to provide evidence? So evidence, at least quoting of evidence, is required. So you can say that as a teacher, I found that students were more happy. These kind of things are there. But if you have a very valid URL, even that is also good enough. So let me, I think, sir.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
You know, the learning curve of students differs from person to person. Mm-hmm. Fine?
Yes.
And my query is, in a mixed ability classroom, how can a teacher cater to the needs of the stakeholders?
Okay. So, again, this is a more generic query. We have a mixed class. So, there will be high achievers, low achievers, medium achievers, etc. How to cater to each and every learner? So, my first answer is, ensure that you set up instructional activities aligned to the objectives. So, you will have objectives or outcomes from a particular course as well as a lesson. So, you set up the objectives from a teacher's side, ensure that the objectives are set up so that you know what each student is expected to achieve, and convey this to the students. So, right at the start of the class, say that at the end of this course, you are expected to do so and so. It should be very measurable and it should be very specific. Then decide your activities to cater to the larger learning objectives, and then ensure that assessment will be aligned to the learning objectives. So, if you actually recollect in FDP 101X, there are learning objectives that we have set for you, and there were 4 or 5 modules. We didn't go in a sequential manner. We actually focused on the key outcomes or the key objectives that was required, and then mix the content which we understood that could be done at your own individual pace. So this, the focus should always be on objectives rather than the syllabus coverage, and that is what outcome based education actually aim for. Okay, so if you ask me, my own personal opinion about syllabus coverage is that unless and until you get the objectives right, there is no point in doing a full syllabus coverage. So let's say you have taught 5 modules within 3 months, and within 3 modules you didn't have enough time to see whether the key objectives of those 3 modules were achieved or not. So if you didn't have enough time to do that, then it becomes very difficult for the students to, then the entire idea of the learning process gets, the effectiveness gets reduced. So that's why the design of activities, the design of the assessment always has to cater to the key learning objectives, and you should set this foundation right. Unless and until you have this foundation right, it will be very difficult. So, all these practical issues will creep up. Time constraint, syllabus is large, all those things will come up. But if you focus on the key skills, the key objectives, then you will see that you could actually do a lot more by doing a lot of these active learning strategies than what you had set it up in the syllabus. I hope I have made it clear.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Okay. Let me take two more RCs. 1026. Sorry, St. Saviour's College, Kanyakumari. Sorry.
How to upload evidence of student feedback in RC 1?
So I think this is a generic query. So see, by evidence, what we mean is what you have seen in the classroom. So the evidence, so even writing it down as text, that is good enough. And if you have, let's say, a very visible effect, then that you can provide URLs or other images. Let's say somebody has captured an image of a think pair share happening in a classroom while they were using screencast. Even that is also, that also you can share with us. I mean, that you can share in the answer. So you just give text. If it is uploaded in a URL, give the URL, complete URL, so that others, your reviewers will be able to see the evidence. So put it as text. It could be a website or it could be experiences. Okay?
Okay, sir. I have already created a thing for another course and I have uploaded it in YouTube.
Okay.
So, my students have commented it YouTube. Suppose I give the link of that YouTube video.
Okay.
That be our evidence for student feedback.
Can you ask that final part? I was not able to hear that final part. So, I heard that you have uploaded video resources in YouTube. After that, your students did something.
Yes. My students have written comments below the YouTube video.
Yeah, that's perfect. That's perfect.
Will that be enough for the student?
Yes. So, that is perfect. So, if you have a YouTube link, you can say that my students have appreciated the video and have provided comments underneath it. And you can just give the link of the YouTube video over there. Copy paste the URL and paste it as answer.
Thank you, sir. That is it.
Yeah. So, this is RC1034.
Good afternoon, sir. Our questions are related to the quiz.
Please go ahead.
Sir, the question being, one, we felt that uploading a question on quiz having images and uploading a question having mathematical expression or symbols becomes a very tedious task. So how could that be done efficiently? That is one question. And the second question being, with respect to a quiz, if I have to give a general feedback to every question, again, it becomes a time-consuming task. So, how could we do it efficiently and effectively?
Okay. Two valid questions. The first one is regarding, so this is regarding upload of quizzes in Moodle. So, it is, point number one, to do a careful assessment process, this is actually a time-consuming process. And what happened is, this is actually a time-consuming process. But what could work out is, before the start of the entire module, you can prepare a question bank. So, there is an option of preparing question banks, and this should be done very much ahead of the start, before the start of the academic session. So, if you actually look into quiz, there is a feature where you can create a question bank, and you should upload your questions in the question bank, and then based on the lesson, you can then fetch appropriate questions from this question bank. So, as you populate the question bank, you can use this question bank continuously. So, it's a one-time creation process, but during subsequent time, this process becomes little easier. Now, regarding upload of image and math, there are also plugins that is available. So, for math equations, Virus Math is a open source plugin that is available with Moodle, where you can actually type in the equations and other things. And Moodle in itself has some mathematical equation editors.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah. So now,
second question, sir.
The second question is regarding feedback. So again, while you are setting up the feedback, some important guidelines. Okay, the question is how to give very specific feedback. Look at the learning by doing activities that we are giving and the feedback that is provided in it. So, for each of these questions, while you are creating the question bank itself, you should think of why you are giving this question and what should the student understand from this question and give feedbacks at that level. So the guideline is, suppose you have given a question, let's say in mathematics, about differential equations. What should the student understand from a differential equation problem? Where is it applicable to them? And so, first of all, writing an overall feedback like at this level is very important. Very specific feedbacks, what you can do is then you can collect, one method is you can collect the quiz results, and based on the performance, you may spend at least 10 minutes in the classroom to give a general feedback, very specific feedbacks on each and every problem, or let's say the important problems that you have already set up in the quiz. Other than that, if you want to give very personal or adaptive feedback, one thing that you can do is you can use the lesson feature in Moodle, where it is the navigation is based on the answers and the responses from the student. You should explore that, but catering to each and every student, it is going to be time consuming, but not an impossible process. You can actually do it. If you want to spend that much time, then it is possible.
It is a time consuming task to prepare a quiz in Moodle.
Yes, it is. It is a So the thing is, see, once you create the same quiz for the next session or the next run of that course, you could use the same questions and the same feedback. So that is the leverage that technology provides. So you, rather than you doing it again and again, once it is there in the question bank, you can reuse that question bank. And that is exactly the idea of open education resources and collaborative communities. So to make the process easier, you should collaborate with other teachers. So this FDP, you have almost 5,000 teachers, not just the teachers from your college. You have 5,000 teachers participating in the same FDP, and you will be interacting with each other in multiple ways. So try leveraging this collaboration and maybe co-creation of content, co-creation of these questions. That is the way to go if you want to tackle the larger problem connected with education. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah. So now what I'll do is I'll be coming with doing a floor transfer and answering the queries of the participants in the afternoon session. But right now I'll go to the questions tab and look at the top questions that has been asked. Okay. The first question, this has been initially put up by PVG's College of Engineering and Technology, Pune. The question is, will you please suggest active learning strategy for the courses where lot of problem solving is required, like mathematics, theory of computation in CS, etc. So again, suggestion of a strategy is not dependent upon the course. Let me remind you, if you look at the teaching learning triangle, the idea is first you set up the objective of the course or objective of that particular lesson, and your decision of active learning strategies should be made upon what objectives you have to achieve. All the active learning strategies are capable of doing multiple are able to cater to multiple objectives. So for example, if it is open-ended problem solving or open-ended design which involves some amount of problem solving, you could do steps of these as think, pair, share. So after the first to think, so let's say this is a mathematical problem where you have to create an equation or let's say create a proof, then you could write the first two steps of the proof and then ask the students to think of the next step and then write it down individually. Then you can do a pair and then share it. So wherever the key misconceptions are there, these kind of problem solving processes can use the think, pair, share strategies. Peer instruction is a very good activity to do along with problem solving process. So you have the steps, and in between you can add a peer instruction question where the question is, okay, in this step, what will happen to the value of X or value of Y? And there are four choices. In IIT, Professor Sahanamurthy had used peer instruction once for discussing the answer paper, where the problem solving questions were present from physics, the subject of physics, for undergraduate students. So she used peer instruction strategies continuously for each and every problems, where she discussed the steps. And first what she did was she found out the problems where students were scoring very less, then took it up, broke it down to individual pieces and inserted peer instruction activities in between the most difficult or complicated step where students can have multiple ideas about it. So to remove the misconceptions, peer instruction is a valid strategy. The same can be done with team pair solo. It could be done using jigsaw. There are a lot of these active learning strategies. But the key takeaway that you should understand is, it's not the course, it's not the the course that actually decides what strategies to take. The strategies have to be aligned with the learning objectives that you have for the course. So based on the learning objectives, then you can think of strategies, technologies that could help you in achieving a particular technology. And there are no one correct answers. It could work out in multiple ways. And it also depends on the context. So the context also has a large bearing on how the strategies, how effective the strategy is. So if it is your first time, think, pair, share may not work as you thought. But when you do it for the fourth or fifth time, then you will have a grip of what think, pair, share is, and you may design more effective strategies. So I hope all the RCs who had the same queries understood the key idea regarding selection of active learning strategies. Okay, how will the lab 1 activity be graded, as there is no link yet? This is a process question. Lab assignments are going to be released mostly by today evening or tomorrow morning. While you are in the lab, your focus should be on completing the lab activity. There will be aligned quizzes that come along with it, like reflection quizzes. Once you do the discussion, then there is a question based on the discussion forum participation. Similarly, in the lab assignment also, the same thing will be repeated. All of you can actually have a look at the course grading policy video, where we have clearly explained when the lab assignment is going to come. Mostly this will be made up by today evening, but to avoid the issue of too many logins the technical issues associated, we may also think of releasing it tomorrow. You will get one full week to complete the lab assignment questions. Okay, how LA will be evaluated? So there will be a separate lab assignment quiz which each of you have to fill based on what you did in the lab. Anna University of Technology Madurai, who have asked, what is the necessity of private file uploading in Moodle? What kind of files can be uploaded? I will have to look at this private file uploading. It may be very specific. I have not done this till now, so it may also be that it could be for select set of students, but I will definitely look into it. Meanwhile, if there are other RCs who know the answer to this, kindly post it to RC1160, who have asked a question regarding private file uploading in Moodle. I am not marking it done. It is available in the questions tab. Phenolex Academy has asked, sir, suggest one good tool for learning strategies used on mobile phone. Mobile based learning. In fact, any of the active learning strategies, okay, you want a tool. It would really see, again, to suggest one good tool or strategy, it would really depend on what is the learning purpose. So do not miss, so this is very foundation. Why are you using a mobile phone inside the classroom? What purpose is being achieved? This has to be answered first. And then, so the, what is the learning purpose? This has to be answered. Then what features of the phone you can use? So let's say, for example, you have a group, the entire group of students in WhatsApp. So WhatsApp typically uses mobile phones. And let's say you want them to a skill like you have posted a question and you want them to answer it on their own. So they could actually use the mic button in the WhatsApp and then say out their answers. So this is like you have the entire answer which they have said and you collect it using WhatsApp. And there are a lot of these tools. So it essentially depends on what is the learning purpose for which you are using it. So if you want the audio collection and you want a repository of the audios to be collected and used, then for that learning purpose, a tool like WhatsApp might be good. There would be other tools, that is again Google Drive or Google Drive applications. Google applications are easily available on Android phone. So if you want to share a file, you could actually ask them to upload using, let's say, taking screenshots within mobile and uploading it in a specific Google Drive that has been shared to them. Again, if it is the information collection, co-creation of content using mobile, these could be used. Other than that, I do not have a very specific answer because this is a very generic question. Okay, so this is a question from RC1088. Which modal features are available to present content in a sequential fashion and non-sequential fashion? So this is like a typical, so I, after doing this, you can go to the next one, or based on the answer, you can divert to a different place. So the feature called lesson can be used for this purpose. So people who have done RCA02 in FTP 101X, what I'll do is I'll post a Moodle link, a video on lesson. So if you look at the learning extension resources in Moodle that we had posted in FTP 101X, there a description of lesson is provided. In fact, a description of most of the tools, features of Moodle are provided as learning extension resources in FTP 101X. So this question is, how yesterday's lab activity is graded? Is it group or individual? So there will be a quiz that is associated with yesterday's and today's lab activity. So you will be continuing with the yesterday's lab activity today, and there will be a lab assignment quiz that will be released most probably today evening or tomorrow morning, which will be associated with your individual activity in the quiz. So it will be done individually. Okay, so this is a question from RC1181, Vivekananda Institute of Technology from Jagatpura, Jaipur, Rajasthan. We have implemented Google Classroom with LBD type videos in it, LED type videos in it basically, and Google Forms as quiz. Is it a valid implementation of ICT in education? Is it a valid evidence? Yes, this is a valid implementation. And the evidence that you collect from Google Forms, seeing what, so what is the evidence? The concept of evidence is connecting it to the larger objectives and then saying that, let's say, n number of students got engaged because they attempted this quiz. The quiz score, the median, the mean quiz score of the class out of, let's say, 10 was, let's say, 6 or 7, which is towards the higher ranges. So you should make these claims, then that will be counted as evidence. So it's not just evidences. So as individual piece, they are valid evidences, but additionally you will have to interpret how this evidence is connected to usefulness of the ICT, then it would make more sense. So I am keeping this question open because of two reasons. One, it is actually showing a valid implementation of ICT, which other RCs can also try at their own places. Other participants can try at their own places. So they have used the Google Forms as a quiz. So this is a feature of Google Forms that they have tried out. So I'm keeping this question open over here in the questions tab. Is there any provision to change the mentor? The first AVU session with the mentor was a complete miss. Also in second AVU interaction, she was present for even less than 1 hour. So regarding the logistics and slotting of mentor-mentee interactions, we will definitely try out something more positive, and we will also encourage all the mentors to be actively participating in it. We will ask the consolidated, so it is important that each of you are available at a particular slot. So we will look at other mechanisms and give generic instruction to the mentors on various ways in which collaboration can happen. Okay, so this is a question from MEPCO Schenck Engineering College. What is the maximum number of users that can be connected in Moodle simultaneously? So IIT Bombay's earlier FDPs, we have connected close to 10,000 users. So we have enrolled 10,000 users, students in a single computer science course. It will really depend upon the system infrastructure you have and the system admin support. But universities like the Open University in London, which have around 1.5 lakh students, they use Moodle for their day-to-day teaching learning process. So it really depends on when all these users are coming together, whether there is a infrastructure to support such concurrent loads. But in theory, you can have any number of students in Moodle. So with this, I'll just close the session for now. We'll come back exactly at 2 o'clock and we'll start the formal floor transfer and answering of the questions.